TOEFL learners, welcome to today's Agricultural Sciences lesson. My name is Zulufe Zega, and this lesson is brought to you by the Northern Cape Department of Education in collaboration with Phakama Research and Development. Our main focus today is on basic genetics. We are just reminding one another on the concepts, right? The important things to take note and study for. Right, by the end of this lesson, learners, you should be able to distinguish between genotype and phenotype, right? Dominant and recessive alleles or gene, describe the Mendel's laws, differentiate between qualitative and quantitative traits, identify the patterns of inheritance, describe the phenomenon, variation, selection, and breeding, right? Describe the concept of genetic modification. Right, now learners, please take note that when you have studied, when you have the question paper right in front of you, you're expected to answer questions. Now, what do you do? The first step, read each question with understanding. Remember, you need to analyze, you need to read once, read twice, up until you remember, up until you know how to attempt or how to answer that particular topic. And please also take note that for a single mark, please spend about a minute, right? For 2 marks, spend about 2 minutes, right? Now, if the question requests you to tabulate the differences between two concepts, please draw the table and label the columns. Like, let's just make an example, right? When you are expected to differentiate between genotype and phenotype, right? On phenotype, you know, just write, label the column of phenotype, label the column of genotype, and then after you can provide the differences, right? Learners must know at least 3 advantages as well as the disadvantages. So here we are referring to the breeding systems. We know that it is the breeding systems that have advantages and disadvantages, or also the genetic modification. Know at least 3, you will be safe for the examination. Right? Always choose the simple ones that a learner can remember. When selecting or studying for advantages and disadvantages, always choose the simple ones, right? The simple ones that you can study for, right? Do not leave blank spaces or do not leave empty spaces on the examination. You have prepared, you have studied. You know these things, right? So know how to answer. Try, even if you don't know the answer, just try on answering the question, right? Now, let us move. Now, we said on our today's lesson, our focus is on basic genetics. Now, what are the things to focus on when studying? Now, understand the laws, 2 laws, law of segregation and law of independent assortment. So how they relate to the 2 crosses, monohybrid cross as well as the dihybrid cross. Thirdly, right, indicate the genotypic ratio as well as the percentage. Know how to indicate the phenotypic ratio as well as the percentage. We know that when it comes to calculating the percentage, we always multiply by 100, right? And our units or values should be in percentages. Right, drawing up or drawing off the Punnett square. You need to know how to draw up a Punnett square, how to draw, right, a schematic representation, right, of genes, right, between 2 parents that are involved, right? You must know how to distinguish between qualitative as well as the quantitative, right? On courses, these are the things you should focus on. Now, when it comes to genetics, let's just remind one another of what genetic is. Now, genetic, we speak of the study of heredity, right? How genes or how characteristics are moved from generation to generations, from parents to offsprings, how offsprings inherit the superior characteristics. Remember, we are running an enterprise, so the only characteristics that we are looking for or focusing on are the superior characteristics. These are the only things that will maximize production and that will give us money. Now, before you even understand where does these characteristics come from, what controls these characteristics, firstly, understand the structure of a cell, right? that a cell has a nucleus. A nucleus has a chromosome. Chromosome made up of two chromatids joined by a centromere, right? And then after we have a gene that controls these characteristics, and then a gene with a DNA or consists of a DNA. Right. Now, understand that when it comes to genetics or heredity, right, it is the gene that controls the characteristics, right? We have different characteristics such as height, such as production, such as weight, such as the color. It is a gene that controls the characteristic. And at all time, a characteristic or a single characteristic is controlled by a single gene. Now, there's a gene for height, a gene for weight, a gene for production, a gene for color, whether a skin color or an eye color. You need to understand that. Right. Now, also, when you are done understanding that it is genes that controls or determines, right, the characteristics, and also a single gene controls a single characteristic, you need to understand that a single gene is made up of two alleles, right? One from the mother and one from the father, right? And these alleles are responsible for controlling a particular characteristics, as I've already indicated that. Now, a gene is always represented by letters, right? It can be the capital letter, it can be the small letter, right? A single gene should have two letters that are representing the allele. Remember? Two alleles, they make up a single gene that controls a single characteristic. Now, a gene should have two alleles. One has to come from the mother and one has to come from the father, right? Now, genes are different. Now, we have genes that are homozygous, right? Meaning they are the same or both alleles are the same. How do you know that this gene is homozygous? By having the capital letter TT or capital letter BB or capital letter RR. Or we can have the small letter TT. One T is a small letter and another one is also a small letter. So this type of gene is homozygous. And all homozygous genes, they always result to pure breeds animals or farm animals, right? Also, a gene can be heterozygous. You need to remember that. You need to know that when you're studying or preparing for the final examination, right? A gene can also be heterozygous, meaning it can be different. How do you know that this gene is different? It is made up of two different alleles. How do you know? One has to be represented by a capital letter T, and another one has to be represented by a small letter T. Yes, we know that these are both T's, right, or T letters, but they are not the same, right? They are non-identical, right? Now, in a case of a heterozygous gene, one allele has to be dominant and the other one has to be recessive. Like just for this one, when a gene is heterozygous or when alleles are non-identical, after the offspring, it is only the capital allele that will be physically expressed. Let's just say this T stands for tallness and this one stands for shortness. Now, this gene is heterozygous, meaning an offspring will be what? It will be tall. Why? Because it is this T that is dominant. Now, at all times, it is a dominant allele that it will be physically expressed on the offsprings. But when it comes to a homozygous gene, both of these will be physically expressed. Why? Because they are homozygous. They are identical, right? Now, when do we experience the expression of a recessive allele? A recessive allele can only be expressed if both alleles are recessive. But once there is an allele that is dominant, this recessive allele will not be expressed on the physical appearance of an offspring, right? I just hope that I'm making sense there. Now, to prove how characteristics are passed on, now, Mendel had to implement two laws. Law of segregation, and then the law of independent assortment. Remember the passing on of characteristics, right? He came up with two laws. The law of segregation, right, states that pairs of alleles segregate during the formation of gametes or meiosis and recombine during fertilization. We know we have done reproduction where we were focusing on right spermatogenesis as well as oogenesis, how the alleles or how genes separate right during the formation of gametes, and they recombine during fertilization. And also, love segregation, it only deals with a single characteristic, right? If it focuses on the height, it looks at the height. It focuses on the weight, it focuses on the weight. If it is based on milk production, it focuses on milk production. That is a single characteristic controlled by a single gene. Now, indicate and to deal with this, right, Mendel's had to use a monohybrid cross, right? And then I will quickly show you about the monohybrid cross. Now, the second law that was implemented by Mendel's, it is the law of independent assortment. That deals with two characteristics. So how does it state? It states that pairs of alleles segregate independently during the formation of gametes and recombine independently during fertilization. Now, this type of law, it speaks about the two characteristics where Mendel's was testing the inheritance of two characteristics or the heredity of two characteristics. Are they related or not related? Is the height related to the skin color, or is the height related to like the production, right? He just wanted to prove that are genes or characteristics related. Now, also you need to understand, right? After understanding the laws, the two laws, law of segregation and law of independent assortment, that there is a genotype as well as the phenotype. Now, what is a genotype? We speak of the genetic makeup of an individual that determines the phenotype. What is the phenotype? The physical appearance of an individual that is determined by the genotype, right? Genotype, we are referring to a gene, right, that controls a specific or a particular characteristic. And then phenotype, we speak of the physical appearance that is determined by a gene. So these are the things you should know when preparing for the examination. Now, for a monohybrid cross, remember we said a monohybrid cross is controlled or guided by the law of segregation. Now, these are the two things you need to know or understand or prepare for, right? The Punnett square, how the Punnett square works, as well as the schematic representation. Remember, we are dealing with a single characteristic controlled by a single gene, and this single gene has two alleles, one allele from the mother, one allele from the father. Right, so this is how a Punnett square looks like. So it's very important to just close in here, right? And this part has to represent the gametes. You can just write the gametes, or you can make signs that this is a male sign and this is a female sign. Right. Now you should know how to combine these to form different or possible offsprings. How offsprings will inherit these alleles or this type of genes, right? Now, using a schematic representation, this is what you need, right? You need two parents, right? Here, we have a dominant parent and we also have a recessive parent, right? This is a gene, this is another gene. How do you know? It is made up of two alleles and this one is also made up of two alleles. Now, what is happening here? Why are these alleles separating? Why is the gene separating, right? They separate during the formation of gametes or during meiosis. This is where they are separating. Why? So that during fertilization, one allele from the mother has to combine with an allele from the father, right? Of which will form a gene that will control a single characteristic. So this is during fertilization. Now, also you should be able to label a schematic representation. You are expected to know that these are the genes or parents. This is meiosis and this is fertilization, or this is during fertilization. Now, also, for a dihybrid cross, right, that is guided by the law of independent assortment, you should know the Punnett square and you should also know the schematic representation. So this is how a dihybrid cross looks like. Remember we said a dihybrid cross, it deals with two characteristics controlled by two genes. And these genes have four alleles in total. Now we are just learning how characteristics are related. Are they related or not related? How do you know that we are dealing with two characteristics? You will look right at these four alleles, right? These are the two alleles, two alleles, right, controlling different characteristics. And these are two genes, right, with four alleles controlling again different characteristics, right? For this one, you should know also. And then when combining this one, you can even, right, start numbering this, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. You know 13, 14, 23, 24. You know this one goes to this one. This one also goes to that one. This one with this one and this one with that one, right? Also, parents F1 generation, right, as well as the F2 generation, you need to know all those things. Now, there are different patterns of inheritance that we look at, the different possibilities of heredity. We normally look at when during genetics or during the heritability or the passing on of characteristics from generation to generations. Now, there are different types of patterns of inheritance, right? Three of these are Mendel's inheritance, and then five of these are non-Mendelian inheritance. You need to know all of these, right? Mendelians, we can name complete dominance, codominance, as well as the incomplete dominance. And then the non-Mendelians, we can name atavism, epistasis, prepotency, polygenic, as well as the multiple allele. Now, let us start with the Mendelian's inheritance, right? This is what Mendel did after continuing with calculating or estimating or implementing more possibilities or calculating more possibilities, right? When it comes to the complete dominance, right? Complete dominance, it occurs between two parents. One parent has to be homozygous dominant. The other one has to be homozygous recessive, right? Let's just make an example. This one is homozygous dominant, and this one is homozygous recessive. Now, one parent will be fully expressed on the offspring. Now, when crossing these two individuals for a color, right? One being homozygous dominant and the other one being homozygous recessive. There's only one parent that will be fully expressed on the offspring, and that will be parent that is homozygous dominant, not the one that is homozygous recessive, meaning an offspring will be red in color if this R stands for red, right? Now, another pattern of inheritance or Mendelian pattern of inheritance, it is the codominance, right? Codominance, it occurs between two homozygous dominant parents, right? Two homozygous dominant parents, right? One is homozygous dominant red, and the other one is homozygous dominant white, right? We can just say RR, we are crossing it with WW, right? This is a capital letter W, please take note. Right, now what happens when crossing two individuals that are homozygous dominant, right? Due to codominant inheritance, both parents will be fully expressed on the offspring. How do you know? An animal or an offspring will show a wrong color, right? Red and white color. Both parents are fully expressed. Right? The last Mendelian inheritance, it is the incomplete dominance, right? Incomplete dominance, it also occurs between two homozygous dominant parents, right? One has a capital letter RR, and the other one has the capital letter WW. Both of them are dominant, right? Now, in this case, let me just put the W's here so that you can understand what I'm saying, right? In this case, both parents will be partially expressed on the offspring. How do you know? An offspring will show an intermediate color. Remember, we are crossing red with white. Red is dominant, as well as white is dominant. So there will be a mixture of these colors where an individual will be pink in color. So this indicates that both parents are partially expressed. They are not fully expressed. Why? Because an offspring shows an intermediate color of which is pink, right? If we're crossing black and white, an individual will show a gray color. If it was blue and white, an individual will show like a green color. That is an example of an incomplete dominant. It is incomplete because both parents are partially expressed. Even when you are explaining or when you are giving a reason or giving reasons why this is an incomplete dominant, you will just say both parents are partially expressed and offspring show an intermediate color. If it is a co-dominance, you will say both parents are fully expressed. Why? Because then offspring shows both colors, or an offspring shows black and white if it is black and white, red and white if it is red and white. A complete dominant. It is a complete dominant because there's only one parent that is fully expressed, and it will always be a parent that is homozygous dominant. Now let us move on to the non-Mendelian's inheritance. Now, non-Mendelian's inheritance, let us start with atavism. There are five of them. Atavism, epistasis, prepotency, polygenic, as well as the multiple alleles. Now, when it comes to atavism, right, we speak of the reappearance of a characteristic that has been absent for many generations. It is the reappearance of a characteristic that has been absent for many generations. And then atavism is also referred to as a throwback. Now, what is the cause of atavism? It is due to a homozygous recessive gene. Due to a homozygous recessive gene. Let's just put the small letter RR. Right. And then another one will be an epistasis. Epistasis, it occurs when the effect of a gene has been changed by one or several other genes, or it has been modified by one or several other genes, right? And this gene is called the modifier gene. Now, what happens during epistasis? Let's just say we have two parents, right? One parent is homozygous dominant, another one is homozygous recessive. This capital letter R stands for red, and this one stands for white, right? Now, an offspring has to be red in color, right? Has to take, right, the characteristic of parent number one. But due to a modifier gene, due to an epistasis, right? Let's just say we have a modifier gene that is green in color, right? Once that is a present of this modifier gene, it will mask this one. Even if this one is dominant, it will mask it. Meaning, at the end of the day, the offspring will be green in color. That is a modifier gene modifying or masking or changing an original gene that has to control a particular characteristic. Now, please take note that this modifier gene can only be effective in its dominant form. Let's just say, when it is G, capital letter G, capital letter G, or capital letter G, small letter G, but it will not be effective if it is small letter G, small letter G. It will not be able to mask or modify the original gene if it is in a recessive form. I just hope I'm making sense, right? And then let us move to another non-Mendelian inheritance, and that will be the prepotent. Right, prepotency, it occurs when one parent transmits more characteristics to its offspring, right? Due to having like homozygous dominant genes for all characteristics. So an offspring will look exactly as that parent with homozygous dominant genes, right? For color, right? An offspring will inherit those type of genes, right? He will look exactly as parent number one if it is parent number one that is homozygous dominant. And also, please take note that prepotency can also be caused by an epistatic gene. It is not only caused by a homozygous dominant gene, but it can also be caused by an epistatic gene. But if a parent has a modifier gene that is masking other genes or masking the original genes responsible for determining other characteristics or particular characteristics. Right, for multiple alleles, right, it occurs when a single characteristic is controlled by more than two alleles. We know that normally a single characteristic has to be controlled by two alleles, right? What happens when we have three or more alleles? That type of inheritance is referred to as a multiple alleles or multiple alleles. Now, example of a multiple allele, we always make blood group as an example. We know that when it comes to blood group, we have blood group A, B, O, AB. There are more alleles that are controlling a single characteristic, being what? Blood group, right? So this is an example. 1, 2, 3, right? Now, let's move to polygenic. Now, polygenic as the pattern of inheritance, it occurs when a single characteristic is controlled by two or more genes. We know that normally when it comes to Mendel's, a single characteristic has to be controlled by a single gene. But in this case of polygenic, you will find two genes controlling a single characteristic. An example, height, an example, weight, an example, like milk production, right? You find that three or more genes are controlling the milk production. So this is it about the patterns of inheritance. You need to identify these for the examination. Now, let us go into our first activity of the day based on the crosses, the Mendel's laws, right? The patterns of inheritance. Right, you only have 1.1 to 1.3, right? Let's get into it. I'll only give you about 4 minutes for this one, and then we'll come back for activity solutions. Right, welcome back, learners. Now, let us get into our first activity solutions, right? So here, a purebred black cow is crossed with a purebred red bull, right? A purebred black cow is crossed with a purebred red bull, right? The offspring of the F1 generation have a black color, meaning they are all black. Use the letters B, capital letter B, and small letter B to answer the questions or the following questions. Identify the type of inheritance or dominance shown above, right? It is indicated that the F1 generation were all black in color, and then cow shows a black color, right? A bull was red in color. Now, the answer for that one will be the complete dominance, right? 1.2, give a reason for your answer to question 1.1. It is for one mark, right? It is a complete dominant. Why? Because only one parent is fully expressed on the offspring, and it is on only the cow's right color that is shown in the F1 generation. So it can be the co-dominant, it can be the incomplete dominance. Remember, incomplete, an intermediate color has to be shown, or both parents has to be partially expressed. And then on the co-dominant, both parents has to be fully expressed. So this one is the complete dominance, right? A purebred black cow is crossed with a purebred bull, right? The offspring of the F1 generation have a black color. Use the letters capital letter B, small letter B to answer the questions or the following questions, right? Now we are determining the following. The genotype of the cow, right? Remember, the F1 generation are all black, meaning the cow is dominant. And this is a purebred. Now, this also indicates that the alleles for this gene are identical, right? Because the F1 generation are all black in color, that will make having this type of gene, capital letter B, capital letter B, right? The genotype of offspring, right? It was said that the F1 generation have a black color of which makes that the genotype of an offspring being capital letter B, small letter B. Remember, offsprings have to inherit from both parents, right? So at the end of the day, we needed something like this one, right? Never mind my Punnett square, right? Black, capital letter, small letters. This is the female, right? This is a male that is recessive. Capital letter B, small letter B, capital letter B, small letter B, capital letter B, small letter B, capital letter B, small letter B. As much as a bull is not physically expressed in the offspring, but there is an allele that controls this recessive, or that there is an allele that controls this particular characteristic. Now, let us move to variation. Now, variation, we speak of the differences in genotype or phenotype among individuals of the same species, right? Why cattle are different? Why do they behave differently? Why do they produce differently, right? Why do they adapt differently to environments, right? Why do they have different resistance, right? Now, for the examination, understand that variation, right, it is caused by two factors. One being the internal factor, also referred to as the genetic factors, right? The second one are the external factors, also referred to as the environment, right? And before you even get into the importance of variation, understand that there are two types of variation: continuous variation and discontinuous variation. Now, why is it important for us to know more about variation, where we are looking at the differences, right? It is to create new cultivars or breeds. It improves the existing breeds or cultivars, right? Breeds, we are referring to animals, right? Here we are referring to plants, right? Also, it is the foundation of selection, meaning without looking at these differences, we'll not be able to select animals that will breed or animals with superior characteristics for breeding purposes. So this is why variation is important. Now, let us quickly look at the external factors that cause variation. Now, external factors that cause variation, or forces, right? We can name the topography. We speak of high altitude, the mountains. We can name the climate. We look at the level of temperature. We can name like light intensity, right? We can name diseases. We can include nutrition or feeding. We can also include exercise, right, on animals. The internal factors, we can name recombination of genes, random fertilization, crossing over, as well as mutation, right? Now, what is mutation? You need to understand that for the examination. How is mutation cause variation, cause differences among individuals of the same species, cause differences in genotype or phenotype among individuals of the same species? Now, mutation, we speak of the sudden change in the structure of DNA, the sudden change in the structure of DNA or genetic material, right? Mutation is caused by various factors, and it is caused by mutagenic agent. Now, we know once there is a change in the structure of DNA, that change will affect the physical appearance of an individual. What happens internally will affect what happens externally, right? What we see on the outside. Now, mutation is caused by the mutagenic agent. Mutagenic agents, they can be chemical, biological, and they can be physical. Now, these are the examples. The nitride is chemical, right? Biological, virus, we can name the pathogens. Once they infect, right, a cell, anything changes. We see an animal losing weight. That is mutation, right? Physical mutagenic agents, we can name X-ray, gamma rays, and sun or radiation. Now, there are different forms of chromosomal mutation. Once mutation has occurred, how does it occur? There are different chromosomal changes that occur in structures or in segments, right? We have different chromosomal mutation. right? Number one, we have deletion, we have translocation, we have duplication, as well as the inversion. Now, how do you know that this is a deletion chromosomal mutation? Right, this is, this one is our normal chromosome. We know that it's the same as chromatid, right? But let's just say it is a chromosome, right? This is our normal chromosome with capital letter A, B, C, D, E, F. Now, when deletion has took place, you know that the original or the chromosome will have to break off, right? One of the segments will be missing, right? From here, a mutation has occurred, right? So now B is now missing, meaning this the chromosome has break off. We are now left with A, C, D, E, F. If one of the segment is missing, you will know that this is deletion, chromosomal mutation. Now, when it comes to this one, this is our normal chromosome or chromatid with A, B, C, D, E, F. Now, when there is duplication or duplication has occurred or took place, we know that there will be a multiplication in the segment, right? Or on segment, right? How do you know, right? This is a mutation taking place. How do you know one of the segments will be multiplied, right? We had ABC, so now after mutation, we have ABBC. Now we have two Bs now, of which indicate that a mutation has occurred or took place, right? Now, when we look at the inversion chromosomal mutation, this is our normal, right, chromosome, right, A, B, C, D, E, F, right? Now, mutation is taking place. What happens? These ones, they need to rotate 180 degrees, right? How do you know? Remember, at this point, we had C, and then after mutation, D has moved to be where C was, right? And then now C has been or is now at point where D was initially before mutation, right? And then translocation, right? This is the example of translocation, right? This is the normal chromosome or chromatid, right? Mutation is taking place. Right? Please take note here. On the very first chromatid, we have the capital letters. On this one, we have the small letters. Now, right, after the mutation, we have A, B, C, D of the capital letters, and then there has been a change or an exchange in the segment. So we now have the small letter E, small letter F, small letter G. And on this one, we have capital letter E and capital letter F. So this is the translocation, right? The segments have been translocated. So this is the chromosomal mutation. Now let's move to selection. Now selection, we said, for us to select, we need to look at the differences. We need to look at the variation. It's very easy to select when individuals are different. We are able to differentiate between individuals that are superior from individuals that are inferior. Now, what is selection? Process of choosing individuals with superior characteristics for breeding purposes. Now, we are not choosing these for fun, but we are choosing these individuals for breeding purposes. We want them to mate and reproduce. We want superior characteristics or favorable characteristics from these individuals. Now, for this one, you need to know that there are two types of selection. We have natural selection and we have artificial selection. Now, natural selection, it occurs naturally, where it is a process by which individuals with favorable characteristics are more likely to survive and reproduce. Those that have favorable characteristics, those that have superior characteristics or desirable characteristics, they are more likely to survive and reproduce, right? It does not involve human interventions. It occurs naturally. But artificial selection, it involves human intervention, where individuals, or it involves the process of unintentional or intentionally choosing individuals to encourage the breeding of certain traits. Now, it is individuals that are selecting, or it is humans that are selecting these farm animals for for breeding purposes, and they are selecting animals with superior carrier tyre sticks, right? There are different, right, methods of artificial selection, right? We have mass selection, we have family selection, we have pedigree selection, and we also have the progeny selection. But before we get into that one, let us look at this activity, of which is activity number two of the day, right? I'll just give you about 5 minutes for this one, and then we'll come back for more remedials. Welcome back, learners. Now let us look at activity number two. Right? The differences in the phenotypes of plants and animals of the same species are influenced by both the genes and the environment. Now, give a genetic term for the phenomenon in the statement above. Because we are speaking about the differences in phenotype and genotype, right, we are looking at variation. Now, the correct answer for that one will be variation, right, caused by external and internal factors. Now, name two environmental factors that can have an effect of these or on this phenomenon, right? We can name nutrition, climate, topography, light intensity, diseases, soil type, as well as the exercise. So these are the examples or the examples of factors that affect or cause variation, of which are differences among individuals of the same species. Now, the differences, right, the same statement, the differences in the phenotypes of plants and animals of the same species are influenced by both the genes and the environment. Now, give two types of selection. We know that there are two types of selection. We have natural selection as well as the artificial selection. Now, here you are not expected to name the methods of artificial selection. Methods are methods, and these are types of selection. Now, as I've already indicated, that there are different methods of artificial selection, right? We have mass selection, where we are selecting individuals. Remember, on selection, we are selecting individuals with superior characteristics. Now, when using the mass selection, we are selecting an individual based on its performance within a field or on the field. How an individual performs when we are comparing it to other farm animals of the same species, right? And these animals are not related, right? And then family selection is based on the relatives' performance, where we are selecting an individual based on the relatives' performance. Let's just say the cousin is performing or has better performance or good performance, right? We'll select you based on the performance of that cousin or relative, yes, right? And another one, it is the progeny selection, right? We are selecting an individual based on the offspring's performance. Let's just say, for us to select individual, right? One, two, three. For us to select individual number three, we don't look at the performance of individual number three, but we will look at the performance of individual number one and individual number two, of which these are referred to as the offsprings, right? How the offsprings are performing, right? For us to select you, we look at the performance of the offsprings, right? By using the pedigree selection, right? For us to select an individual, we need to look at the ancestor's performance, right? How an ancestor used to perform. So this is how we'll select that particular individual or farm animal for breeding purposes. So these are the methods of artificial selection. Now, after selection, what happens? We need to breed, we need to mate these farm animals, right? We are selecting individuals that are superior or that have superior characteristics or that have favorable characteristics. Now, what is breeding, right? A process of mating. We are allowing these individuals to mate, right? Individuals that possess particular characteristics in order to bring about an improvement in the progeny. Now, after mating these individuals, an offspring that will be formed or a result of breeding is known as a progeny. And this progeny should have superior characteristics. That is why when selecting, we are selecting individuals with superior characteristics. Now, there are different methods or processes or methods of breeding, right? We have line breeding, we have inbreeding, we have line breeding, outbreeding, also known as outcrossing, right? Crossbreeding, upgrading, species crossing. Now, for these breeding systems, or six breeding systems, you need to understand the advantages as well as the disadvantages. So you should be able to identify them even in the examination by just looking at the pictures, looking at the diagrams. Now, an inbreeding system, it is when we are mating individuals that are closely related. So usually it will be a bull and a bull's daughter, right? An example of that, we can take a Sussex bull and we can mate it with a Sussex daughter, right? So this daughter, this offspring is a daughter of this bull. So we are just mating these individuals. And this type of breeding system is known as an inbreeding. Why? Because these individuals are closely related. And another example, right? Son and a mother, right? Two siblings that share the same mother and the same father, right? Advantages of this breeding system, right? It brings about strong prepotency, the uniformity, good genes are maintained within the family. And then the disadvantages, it leads to lethal genes, it leads to a reduced, right, variation, right? Most of these, they can't even adapt to different environments, right? There are a lot of disadvantages, right? A lot of disadvantages relating to inbreeding system, right? Another breeding system is known as the line breeding, right? Line breeding, it is mating individuals that are distantly related. And it should be individuals that share a common ancestor, right? It can be like the cousins, half siblings, right? And it must be the individuals that share the common ancestor, right? Granny, right? If I can put it that way, right? So this is the type of diagram you should be looking for in the examination. So as you can see, these ones are connected by a single ancestor, of which is N. Now, the advantages. The advantages of line breeding are the same as the advantages of inbreeding and the same as the disadvantages of inbreeding system. Now, outcrossing. Now, outcrossing, it is mating of unrelated individuals, right? It has to be individuals of the same breed, right? Nguni and Nguni, Sussex and Sussex, Hereford and Hereford, but it has to be individuals of the same breed, same species, yes, but that are not related at all. Now, the advantages of outcrossing. The least likely system to produce any problems or any deformities. Why? Because these individuals are not related. But when it comes to line and inbreeding, more of deformities we experience. There are more of deformities than we experience in those breeding systems, right? And then number two, offspring will carry the traits or characteristics, right, of both parents, right? Why? Individuals are not related, meaning there is no strong prepotency, right? It improves genetic diversity or new bloodline is introduced. Why? They are not related, even though they belong to the same breed and same species. Now, crossbreeding. Mating individuals of the same species but different breeds. How do you know? A milk cow and a meat bull. These are animals of the same species, but different breed, right? Nguni, Hereford, right? Nguni, Sussex, Hereford, Sussex. So these are the examples of crossbreeding. Same species, different breeds. Advantages, there's more variation. It leads to an increased hybrid vigor, meaning an offspring is able to obtain characteristics from both parents or superior characteristics from both parents, right? And these individuals are more stronger. They are able to adapt to different environments, right? Disadvantages, it may lead to dystocia. If a bull, we have mated a larger bull and a small cow, an offspring may be a bit larger or bigger, and that can result to dystocia, of which is difficult birth, right? Another one, it is upgrading. Now, how do you identify upgrading? Right here, we are mating, we are improving, right, the animals. How? By mating an inferior female with a superior bull. And this superior bull is often called a stud bull. Mating individuals, one has to be inferior and the other one has to be superior, right? Now, advantages of this, new breed is imported, right? Deformities occur less. Why? Because they are not related at all, right? Disadvantages, it may be expensive, right, for some farmers, because you will have to buy a bull or a semen, right? It's very expensive, right? Or a bull has to be imported into the country, right? And another disadvantage, there is slow improvement after the third generation, right? The last breeding system that we have, it is the species crossing, right? Crossing individuals of different species, meaning even the breed is different, right? Now, what are the advantages of breeding or of using species crossing, right? Where you are crossing a donkey and a horse, right? These individuals are more hardy, they are more stronger, they adapt well to unfavorable conditions. But the only disadvantage of this is that the offspring is often, or the offspring most of the time is sterile, meaning it results to loss of fertility, like permanently, right? So this is the only disadvantage of using the species crossing as a breeding system. Now let us go into our third activity of the day, right? That is activity number three, right? You only have like four questions, right, based on this one, and then I will come back for more remedials. Now, welcome back, learners. I just hope you are done writing, right? You are writing out of 4 marks, right? Now, let's get into the activity solutions. Indicate the breeding system applicable to each of the following, or to each of the situations below. Remember, we have 6 in total of the breeding systems: the inbreeding, line breeding, outcrossing, crossbreeding, upgrading, as well as the species crossing. So you need to choose from the 6, right? It results in a large increase in the performance of the offspring, and that will be the crossbreeding or upgrading, right? 3.2 leads to a gradual decrease in the performance of the offspring from generation to generation. That is an inbreeding, meaning an inbreeding, it has a disadvantage of that it leads to an inbreeding depression. But we'll discuss more about that on our next lesson. What is an inbreeding depression? Right. And then another one, new breed is gradually brought into a new environment with fewer adaptation problems. Right, a new breed is gradually brought into a new environment with fewer adaptation problems, and the answer will be upgrading. Remember, we said sometimes we need to buy the bull from another country, so it has to be imported into this country where it will be used. Right, 3.4 gives rise to sterile progeny, but that is the species crossing, so that is for activity number 3. Now let us move on to genetic modification. Now, what are you expecting from genetic modification in your examination? Now, genetic modification, please remember that we are manipulating genes outside an organism's normal reproductive system, right? Now, there are different techniques that are involved. You should be able to identify these, right? We speak of microinjection, electroporation, chemical poration, biolistic, also referred to as the gene gun, bacterial carrier, viral carrier, recombinant DNA, there are a number of them. So you need to use this technique to identify this type of process or technique, this type of process in the examination. Right now, what are the aims of using genetic modification, right? Implants, or the implication, implants, right? It leads to plants that are drought tolerant, right? Disease resistant, right? Plants with improved shelf life that last longer, plants with high nutritional value that have more nutrients, plants with fast growth, plants with better taste, plants with an improved yield, right? When it comes to the animals, right? Genetic modification gives us animals that are more resistant to diseases, that have high fertility, that have high production, whether milk, wool, eggs production, right? That adapt well to harsh conditions, that are more resistant, right, to diseases. Now, what are the advantages of genetic modification? You need to understand this, that aims are different from advantages, or implications are different from advantages, right? The first advantage you are looking for, it is precise, right? Meaning it is accurate. Remember, we are just removing an inferior gene and we are replacing it with a superior gene. Remember, a gene that controls a characteristic, it's just a gene. Genes are the same, just that we have those that are dominant and those that are recessive, right? It is precise, it is accurate, right? Firstly, it is faster than breeding or the normal breeding process. Right? It is not limited to individuals of the same species, unlike the normal reproduction or the normal breeding systems. Right? Now, you need to understand that as much as there are more implications or advantages of genetic modification, also referred to as genetic engineering, right? There are risks that are associated with this type of process. Right? Risks such as economic risk, that it is expensive, right? Environmental risk, it reduces biodiversity, it affects beneficial insects, right? It reduces the effectiveness of pesticides or herbicides, right? Health risk, it reduces the effectiveness of the immune system, the effectiveness of antibiotics. So there are a lot of risks associated with genetic modification, and you need to know these by heart when preparing or when studying for the final examination. Now let us get into our last activity of the day, and that will be activity number 4, right? I'll just give you 5 minutes for this one, and then I'll come back for activity solutions. Welcome back, learners. Now let us get into our activity solutions, right? Now, number 4, a cotton farmer realizes that production is decreasing annually because of a bollworm contamination. The crop is sprayed for bollworm at least 6 times a season. The farmer is advised to use genetically modified seeds as an alternative. As a result, the need to spray the bollworm is reduced to once a season, and the yield doubles during the first harvest. Now, identify the advantage of using genetically modified seeds over traditional seeds, right? The answer will be yield is doubled during the first harvest. That is the advantage. Now, state 2 possible techniques that are used to modify the cotton seeds, right? We can name the bacterial carrier, the viral carrier, biolistic, also referred to as gene gun, microinjection, electroporation, and chemical poration. You can even include the recombinant DNA, right? Now, the next one, state 2 economic benefits of using the genetically modified cotton seeds based on the scenario, right? And that will be to reduce cost for pesticides, and also it results to higher yield, meaning if there's more higher yield, there will be more income. So these are the advantages or benefits of using genetically modified crops or seeds based on the scenario. Remember, you don't have to create your own. If the question says says based on the scenario, your answer should be based on the scenario. Just copy and paste, you analyze, and then you can write and be able to answer, right? Now, on our today's lesson, it is based on heredity, the passing on of characteristics from generation to generations, from parents to parents. And to show this, we used two crosses, monohybrid cross and a dihybrid cross. Monohybrid cross, it involves a single characteristic and it works. It is guided by the law of segregation. Dihybrid cross, it uses two characteristics guided by the law of independent assortment. Right. We also looked at the different patterns of inheritance, like the Mendelian's inheritance and the non-Mendelian's inheritance. Mendelian's, codominance, incomplete dominance, complete dominance. Non-Mendelian's, atavism, epistasis, polygenic, prepotency, and multiple alleles. Right. We also look at different phenomena such as variation, where we are discussing more about the differences among individuals of the same species. We looked at selection, where we are choosing individuals with superior characteristics for breeding purposes, and then breeding, where we are actually mating these individuals, right, to produce an offspring or to form an offspring called progeny with superior characteristics. And we looked at, right, a biotechnology process or technique known as genetic modification, also referred to as genetic engineering, on how we can manipulate genes to produce, right, individuals, transgenic in organisms with superior characteristics, right? On our next lesson, it will be based on how to answer the high order questions based on genetics. So we'll be focusing more on the heritability, the biometrics, and how to do more on how to estimate, right, the heredity between two characteristics, and we'll be using that more of dihybrid cross, right, where we'll focus more on law of segregation as well as law of independent assortment, heritability biometrics, estimated breeding value or estimated biological value, techniques of genetic engineering. So thank you so much for watching this lesson. We'll see each other when we come back, right? Stay blessed.